Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. Draw your attention to the back of your bulletin as well as the blue insert. Most of that is self-explanatory, so you can look at that on your own. Bible study today, we'll have to see how it goes. The service may go a little longer, and if I get to be like the lawyer talk at the end of ads where it gets really quick, do give me a timeout sign, because I know that's in me already, I can tell. Wanting to talk really fast, and so I'll try to slow down a little bit. But there's some great stuff this morning to share with you. Are there any, I've got a letter to read to you in a moment, but are there any other announcements or prayer concerns this morning? If not, what I'm going to share with you is a letter from our presiding bishop, Bishop Elizabeth Eaton, the presiding bishop of the whole church, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, the ELCA. She quotes Psalm 22, verse 1 to begin with. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me? In the words of my groaning. She writes, Dear Church, as Lutherans we are accustomed to holding tension between two truths. Thus the ELCA denounces the egregious acts of Hamas, acts that have led to unspeakable loss of life and hope. At the same time, the ELCA denounces the indiscriminate retaliation of Israel against the Palestinian people, both Christian and Muslim. For the past week we have borne witness to the horrors of the escalating crisis between Israel and Hamas. We also watch a growing humanitarian crisis in Gaza as Israel blocks food, water, fuel, and medical supplies, and as airstrikes continue to cause unbearable civilian casualties ahead of a just announced ground assault. We see Israelis and families around the world in the agonizing wait for word about the fate of loved ones killed or taken hostage by Hamas. We are in anguish, grieving and praying for all people who are living in trauma, fear, and uncertainty. Among us are Palestinian Lutherans who are fearful for their families, their communities, and their homeland. In our communities, we have Jewish and Muslim neighbors who are also facing the horrors of this crisis and its impact on their loved ones. It is difficult to find words that suffice in the complexity of this moment and in the web of relationships that bind us together. As a church, with the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Jordan and the Holy Land and our interreligious partners, yet God has called us to be a people who stand with others amid suffering. We also call a thing a thing. The power exerted against the Palestinian people through the occupation, the expansion of settlements and the escalating violence must be called out as a root cause of what we are witnessing. We are committed to our long-standing accompaniment of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Jordan and the Holy Land. The God who liberates us calls us to be a liberating witness. May it be so. In Christ, the Reverend Elizabeth A. Eaton. And she also lists some resources, some places that you can look for other statements from the ELCA, how to join in praying for peace on Wednesdays, call your lawmakers, and gives a number there. If you go on, you can also contact me, but you can go online and find this. I've got a few copies of this. If you need more, if you want to read that again, it's out in Narcos. Challenging, isn't it? There's always two sides to a story, and certainly that is true, I think, in this case. And the problem is it's so easy to be on one side or the other and not to see both sides, and that's challenging. And I don't want to get political or anything in that vein here, but the reality of our scripture today, the reality of the history of Israel and everything that goes into that, there's a lot to be mindful of and prayerful for. So as we move forward, let us be so. Let us be prayerful and mindful of all that's going on. The song that the choir is going to sing today, I think, is powerful as well in that. And I'll mention that. Let us stand then and join together in our confession, printed on page one of your bulletin. Blessed by God, the one who forms us, Jesus who bears the cross, the Spirit who makes our joy complete.
Amen.
Let us bow before God in humility, confessing our sin. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice,
yet we fail to follow you.
We are
overwhelmed by the growing violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others.
For the harm we have caused, known and unknown, forgive us. For the unjust demands we place on others and your creation, forgive us.
Lead us back to you. Set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
I invite you to not look at your bulletin at this point. If you want to close your eyes, you can. But I want you to hear these words of absolution. Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are already and always forgiven. Amen. Amen. Let's join together in singing our opening hymn, O Day of Rest and Gladness, 521. 521.
Oh, dear, rest and
your bulletin and join in prayer today. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of deliverance, you saved the people of Israel and chose Joshua to lead your people to the promised land. Choose us and equip us to live with faith and peace. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. I mentioned this choir piece fits, I think, pretty well, kind of the not only the theme of the text, but that you'll hear in a minute, but the challenge of what's going on in the Middle East. I want you to hear it, but if you want to look at the words too, it's a familiar tune, I believe, Finlandia. The word, it's 887. Not that you, I want you to see us too, so it's kind of a mix. But the words are powerful, so later go back and look at the words. But listen for the words and the challenge, the two truths that are a reality here.
Thank you.
scripture reading this morning, we start with responsive reading of Psalm 78, 1 through 8. Give ear, O my people, to my teaching.
Incline your ears to the words of my mouth.
I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark saying from of old.
Things we have heard and known that our ancestors have told us.
We will not hide them from their children. We will tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders that he has done.
He established a decree in Jacob and appointed the law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach their children.
That the next generation might know them, the children yet unborn, and rise up and tell them to their children.
So that they may set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments.
And that they should be like their ancestors, a stubborn and rebellious generation.
A generation whose heart was not steadfast, whose spirit was not faithful to God.
Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The lesson this morning is from Joshua 24, 1-26. Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders to the heads of the judges and the officers of Israel. And they presented themselves to before God. And Joshua said to all the people, thus said the Lord God of Israel, long ago your ancestors, Terah and his sons, Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates and served other gods. Then I took your father Abraham from beyond the river and led him through all the land of Canaan and made his offspring many. I gave him Isaac, and to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. I gave Esau the hill country of Seir to possess, but Jacob and his children went down to Egypt. Then I sent Moses and Aaron. I plagued Egypt with what I did in its midst. And afterwards I brought you out. When I brought your ancestors out of Egypt, came to the sea. And the Egyptians pursued your ancestors with chariots and horsemen to the Red Sea. When they cried out to the Lord, he put darkness between you and the Egyptians and made the sea come upon them and cover them. And your eyes saw what I did to Egypt. Afterwards, you lived in the wilderness a long time. Then I brought you to the land of the Amorites who lived on the other side of the Jordan. They fought with you, and I handed them over to you, and you took possession of their land, and I destroyed them before you. Then King Balak, son of Zippor of Moab, set out to fight against Israel. He sent and invited Balaam, son of Beor, to curse you, but I would not listen to Balaam. Therefore he blessed you, so I rescued you out of his hand. When you went over the Jordan and came to Jericho, the citizens of Jericho fought against you, and also the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, and Jebusites, and I handed them over to you. I sent the hornet ahead of you, who strode out before you, the two kings of the Amorites. It was not by your sword or by your bow. I gave you a land on which you had not labored, and towns that you had not built, and you lived in them. You eat the fruit of vineyards and olive yards that you did not plant. Therefore, revere the Lord, and serve him in sincerity and faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the God of your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me, my household, we will serve the Lord. And the people answered, far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who did these great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went, and among all the people through whom we passed. For the Lord drove out before us all the people, Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God. But Joshua said to the people, you cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good. And the people said to Joshua, no, we will serve the Lord. Then Joshua said to the people, you are witnesses against yourself that you have chosen the Lord to serve him. And they said to him, we are witnesses. He said, then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel. The people said to Joshua, the Lord our God we will serve, and him we will obey. So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and made statutes and ordinances for them in Sheshem. Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of God, and he took a large stone and set it up there under the oak in the sanctuary of the Lord. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
I invite the children forward at this time for a story. So we're talking about Joshua. Any guesses as to which story, the only story in this Bible that they have about Joshua? Jericho. Yep. Got it. How's everyone this morning? Good, good, good. All right, so let's see. We see some big walls here, right? There's some big walls, and the people up on the behind the big walls, how do they look? What do they look like? They're kind of like, what's going on? Don't you think they kind of look a little bit afraid? Not sure what's going on. And these people are outside walking around and they're blowing, looks like horns of some type. They're called shofars. So this is the story of the battle at Jericho. The Israelites had finally gotten to the land God promised. They stood outside the tall, tall walls of the city called Jericho. God told Joshua that it was time for them to take over the city. Joshua told the Israelites about God's plan. Here's what we will do, said Joshua. Joshua counted off seven priests from the group. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You will each play a shofar, one of those horns. Keep blowing all the time, even if your lips get tired. Your lips would get tired if you keep blowing that for a long time, right? Next, Joshua looked at the soldiers in the group. Grab your weapons and walk in front of the priests. The rest of you walk behind the priests. Everyone needs to walk quietly. Any questions? Let's go. The horns were loud. The people of Jericho could hear them through the thick stone walls of the city. What was happening? The Israelites kept walking. Left, right, left went their marching feet around the city. The Israelites wondered how God's plan was going to work as they looked at the thick city walls. The Israelites did this for 6 whole days. The people of Jericho watched every day. They had never seen anything like this before. Should they be afraid or should they laugh? It's because these people are trying to get in the wall to capture that city, to take over that city. On the 7th day, the Israelites got up at sunrise and walked around the city 7 times. After the 7th time, Joshua told the people to shout. right after the priests blew their horns the last time. God's plan was for the walls to fall flat when the Israelites shouted. The Israelites shouted so loud the ground began to shake, the thick stone walls began to shake, and soon they started to crumble. Huge stones crashed to the ground. The wall came a-tumbling down. The Israelites got what God promised. Interesting. That was an interesting battle, wasn't it? Not what a typical battle would be where they fight. They just shouted and the walls came tumbling down. God's faithfulness. Let's pray. Lord, thank you that we have stories like this that remind us that you are faithful in giving us what you promise, even as challenging as sometimes it can be. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, thanks for coming up, you guys. So if you were here with us last week, we heard from last week that Moses was giving his farewell address to the people as they stood on the verge of entering into the promised land, into the land that God had promised to them. And we heard Moses, I talked about Moses was like a parent standing before a child that he was dropping off at college and giving them those last words of advice, reminding them who they are, how God had delivered them, and how God had set before them these statutes and ordinances, these commandments. And all of that was there for them so that their life could be as good as possible, that they would maintain that relationship with God as well as with each other. Today, we're kind of in the same situation. Joshua is doing much the same thing. However, Joshua is now in the land that God had promised them, but his life was about to end, and a lot has happened in the life and history, and I use the word history a little guardedly there, but in the life and history of Israel up to this point, and we'll get there in a minute. The book of Joshua is mostly an account of how the people of God then entered in to the land that God had promised them. Now, on the one hand, reading the book of Joshua can be, I think, a little overwhelming at times. In some ways, it's a rather gruesome picture of three distinct military campaigns, if you will, or in this case, a shouting match, with the entry into the promised land as they conquer the land. The first of these campaigns happened soon after they did cross into, they crossed the Jordan, but that crossing was not by any means a military fanfare. It was more of a liturgical event. If you recall, God tells the, through Joshua, tells them to take the Ark of the Covenant. Remember, they've got that ark that has the Ten Commandments in it, as well as some manna, and there's something else in there. I can't remember what's in there, horns or something. But anyway, but things from their past in the Ark of the Covenant, and they tell the priest, the Levitical priest, to walk into the Jordan River, and what happens? Remember? Much like the Red Sea, where Moses, you know, Charlton Heston raised up his hands, right? And the sea parts, and the people walk on dry land, the same thing happens here. The Jordan River stops flowing, and the people are able to enter in to the promised land across the Jordan. They are then told, each one member of each of the 12 tribes of Israel are told to pick a stone and bring it to the other side, and there assemble an altar in remembrance of that particular event. And so that's their entry. Some of these scenes then, as we heard in Jericho, but most of the scenes are harder to handle because it describes how God instructs the people in a military fashion to basically annihilate all the ites that are there, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Jebusites, and all the other ites you heard in the reading, right? They are to annihilate them, to completely wiped them out. However, I think the real goal of the book of Joshua is not to give a factual report of Israel's conquest of the land, but rather to proclaim the dramatic story of God's victory that comes through this prophet, Joshua. As you read these accounts of the victories that they had, the point is that they come not because of their military might and power or strategy, but because it is God, the Lord God, who brought them into this land and provided victory over their opponents. That's why I say I'm a little guarded about looking at it as Israel's history. Because, like so many other books in the Bible, I don't think they're necessarily intended to be looked at as historical documents. Now, I'm sure you know people for whom, again, that is not the case. I mentioned that when we started this whole thing in early September, right? I mean, there are people for whom that say, the Bible says it, that's the way it is. It's historical, it's facts. Again, I just don't think that's the way the Bible is intended to work, especially in this case. I was recently reminded, and I think this helps me at least, and I mentioned this earlier in a different way, but instead of it being history, it is his story, right? Think of it that way, as it is God's story, not history, but his story, right? It's God's story. And if that's the case, some of what we read is historical, certainly, but it isn't necessarily the primary intent. The importance is, again, what has God done? What is God doing, and what will God continue to do? Those are the important questions to be asking ourselves. Sure, there are historical things that we need to read. And like I said, there certainly were three distinct military campaigns that happened as Joshua and the people entered the land. But it is God who allowed them to do that, right? And it is God's faithfulness that did that. So those three campaigns, let me describe quickly. That first campaign was into the central part of Israel. Jericho is right there, crossing the Jordan. We heard that story, and other stories are in the first part of Joshua, describing how they took the central part of the land. The second campaign moved them south into Canaanite territory, hill country. And again, the challenge of those texts are that it describes that there were no survivors, that all the people were exterminated, that the conquest was total and complete. The same is true as the third campaign that moves north and leads them into that territory. It's a little challenging reading those stories. But there's two things I think to note in all of that as we look forward. One is it's important to think about the geography and the world situation at the time. If you think of Israel, and where it is, and I use my hand this way because here's the Mediterranean Sea, right? I mean, I think that's the right direction for you. Or maybe it's not for me. It would be this way, wouldn't it be? This way it would be better for you because the Mediterranean Sea would be here, and Israel would be this piece of land. What's in the north? Well, it's Lebanon at the time with its rich Lebanon cedar forests, right? What's down here? Egypt with the Nile River. Well, how do you get from there to here, or from here to there? You cross this little strip of land. You either have to go by ship, which back then wasn't as efficient, or you cross this piece of land, which is Israel, right? Anybody read The Source by James Michener? I tried. It's like this thick, and it's thick reading. I didn't get very far, but in that he describes the land of Israel, and he describes an archaeological dig, a tell they call it, where they dig straight down a kind of a separated, dig a trench through the land, and you can see the layers of one civilization upon the other. And in Israel, that's exactly what happened. Whoever had the most power came in and wiped the people that were in there out. They built their new society, and then they got fat and happy, and the next civilization came in, wiped them out, and built the new. And because it was the traders, that was, you wanted to be in power, right? You wanted that land because you got fat and happy. And that happened over, over, over again. That's what Michener describes, and that's exactly what happened. And at this particular time in history, when Joshua enters into the land, the problem was that Egypt was being occupied by other things that were distracting them, and others around them were not, they were also distracted. And so Joshua and the Israelites being able to enter, the powers that be in there weren't as strong as they might have been. So it all worked well for them to be entering into the land. So that's the geography and the world situation. The second thing to keep in mind is that although these battles and conquests, as I described, seemed to be complete, that there were no survivors, what Arnie read today sure sounded like there were survivors, didn't it? He was warning them about worshiping the gods of all these ites, right? And what the reality was is that maybe they didn't eliminate everyone. That more, they might have assimilated into the land, and they actually intermarried with some of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Jebusites. And so, as a husband, I would honor my wife by worshiping her gods, right? And likewise in other, the other way around. So again, the point is not to give a historical or factual account of Israel's entry in the Promised Land. Rather, the purpose of the book is to again, proclaim the dramatic victory that the Lord brought about through this man, Joshua. And remember, Joshua's name literally in Hebrew means the Lord is salvation, which, if you remember, is Jesus' name in Hebrew. His name is Joshua. Jesus is his Greek name. Lord is salvation fits Jesus pretty well, right? But more importantly than all of this, the point of this writing is to make sure that the people remember, again, that these victories were won not by their own might and power, but by the Lord who brought them there and was leading them to overcome this land. So that brings us to the reading for today, this end of Joshua. And again, it's a farewell address, but it's really his second. There is a one that comes just the chapter earlier. The first thing you probably noticed in this text as Arnie was reading it is that it recounts God's story, his actions throughout their history, right? From Abraham and on, through Moses, delivering them out of the hands of Pharaoh's hands and walking through the darkness of their wilderness wanderings. And that led them to the many battles, as I've already described, as they enter into this land. A land now that they are occupying, in which they've discovered rich vineyards and olive groves, right? And in the midst of the retelling of their history, however, what is the thing that, is there anything that popped out to you as Arnie was reading that, or as you looked at the text? Did you notice the pronouns, especially in the first part of it? Pronoun I, especially, because God is describing God's self, right? I lifted up Abraham. I gave him Isaac. I gave Jacob. I sent Moses. I brought you out of Egypt. I brought you to this land. I counted 17, if I counted correctly, I's in which God is describing all the ways in which God did all this for the people. It all ends with Joshua then giving the people this imperative statement. Now therefore, revere the Lord and serve the Lord in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods of your ancestors that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Then Joshua gives us probably the most memorable of all these. These are the ones that are probably hanging on your wall at home, right? Choose this day whom you will serve. Why that statement? Why that warning? Why have that choice put before them? Well, seems pretty obvious, doesn't it? Given their history and probably their present practices, they weren't revering the Lord or serving the Lord. Again, probably because some of them had intermarried and they were worshiping the gods of their husbands or wives or families. But then Joshua ups the ante even more. He puts a little emphasis in those famous words, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And that's the question that really hits us, isn't it? The challenge that we face. Will we serve the Lord like Joshua? Will we follow? Will we put away our other gods? I hard to choose. I mean, in some ways we think, well, of course I would choose that. And I could go a long time into that, but I'll try not to. Part of the question is, can you choose? Can you really make that choice? It seems like a no-brainer, and as Israel, I mean, for them it was a no-brainer. Of course we'll choose the Lord, right? I mean, my picture is that they're kind of like and it fits for me because I experienced this lots of times. You're standing at the entrance as a football player, or probably any sport, but going into a stadium or out onto the football field, and the coach has said what? "I've worked you hard this past week. I've given you all the information you need. I've prepared you. I've done this, I've done this, I've done this. Go out there and be victorious. You can do this. Are you ready? Are you ready?" And what do they say? "Yes!" Right? I mean, every football, I mean, one of my favorite things, sorry, it was a tangent, but one of my favorite things as a football coach is the head coach said, "We're going to walk out onto the field absolutely silent. And this was our near town competitor. We're going to do all our calisthenic warming up silent. Just to freak them out." And it did. It worked. Our guys, it was like a balloon. Our guys were like, you know, they want to get out there, hit each other in the head and everything. Our guys were just, it all had to stay in here. And when that whistle blew to start the game, boom, it came out. And it was a great game. But not here. We will follow. We're ready. We will serve the Lord. And Joshua questions them, really? Do you really know what you're talking about here? I mean, they're like eager puppies. Wait, we can do it. We will serve God. Joshua restates the proposition. You know what it means to serve the Lord, he says? What it means is to give up all those other gods. It means losing yourself. It means looking out for the needs of others above yourselves. It means giving away your stuff and seeing that you have been blessed, but blessed to be a blessing to all the other people around you. That means sacrifice, hard work, and a willingness to put yourself second, and much more. You can almost hear the gasp of the people, much like I'm sure you can feel it on your own. And yet they can reaffirm their commitment. They look at what God has done for them. They say, "We will serve and obey the Lord." It's all a pretty powerful picture. But Joshua knows better. And he knows that Israel cannot make that choice. And in the course of their history, their story from there forward, they fail in many ways. And Joshua then in verse 19, you don't have verse numbers, but you heard it. And I'm guessing you were confused by it. Joshua says, "You cannot serve the Lord. For the Lord is a holy God. He is a jealous God. God will not forgive your transgressions or your sins." Again, there's a lot more that requires to talk about, but I'll try to be brief. First of all, I think Joshua is both right and wrong in that statement. He's right in the fact that you and I cannot choose God. I know that sounds odd, but Luther understood it perfectly. Remember Luther's, the beginning of Luther's third explanation of the third article of the Creed, Luther writes, "I cannot. I cannot by my own understanding nor effort believe in Jesus Christ my Lord and come to you." But, right? There's always my favorite word, but. But God can. God has, and God always will, choose you. And that is what allows us then, because then it's not a matter of salvation, right? It's a matter of our choosing to live in that we are children of God, not by our own choice or effort, but by God choosing us, claiming us as God's own. Then we get to make the choice of how will we live into that. It's not a matter of salvation. It's a matter of service. Right? It's a matter of service. And that's a choice we can make. How will we live into the promise that has been given to us? So that's where Joshua was right. I cannot, but God can. And thankfully, Joshua was wrong about the other parts, about God not forgiving our transgressions and our sin, because God has and does and always will forgive your sin. That's why I wanted you to listen today to that absolution. Because if that wasn't true, Jesus dying was pointless, right? So the point of all this boils down, at least for me, is that like Joshua to his people and me to you now, we have gathered here today to pause, to listen, to reconsider, and remember that God has led us in the past, that God has been faithful. And as we reconsider and remember God's faithfulness, that we might then have our own faith built up so that we can, in a way, choose once again this day whom we will serve. As we enter into his story, into God's story, then we can enter more fully and willingly into our own history. And we can do so in love and in service to the world around us. That's the relationship that God wanted with God's people then. And that's the relationship that God longs for and wants us to remember again today. You are loved. You are valuable. And you are called to serve this God who is faithful. Amen.
Thank you.
trusting in the transformative power of God's loving Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Let us pray. We pray for the Church of Jesus Christ in this and every land, that all followers of Christ share the mind of Christ and strive to live together in peace, staying firm in the Lord. God of grace, hear our prayer. For green pastures and still waters and all the beauty of the natural world, that creation flourishes and humankind lives in right relationship with all that you have made. God of grace, hear our prayer. For the nations of the world and all who hold positions of authority, that they govern in accordance with God's vision of justice, providing shelter and refuge to all who are in need, striving toward the goal of peace and prosperity for all. Indeed, we pray that all for our brothers and sisters in the Middle East. God of grace, hear our prayer. For all experiencing valleys of illness and grief, that they be healed and comforted and find rest in the presence of our Good Shepherd who walks beside us. We pray especially today again for all who are on our prayer list, and we lift up in silence those others we know to be in need. God, give them peace. Give them the assurance of your presence with them. Touch them with your healing hand. God of mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for this community we call First Evangelical Lutheran Church, that wherever there is conflict or discord, let the love of Christ keep us united and make us mindful of all that is true and honorable, just, pure, pleasing, commendable, and excellent. God of grace, hear our prayer. In thanksgiving for the beloved saints who now rest in your mercy, we pray that their faithful witness guides us until the day that we join them at your heavenly feast. God of grace, hear our prayer. Gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your unending love and in your amazing grace, given to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. This time we receive our offering.
To you. We bring your gifts to the table, that all may be fed.
Indeed, we have come to this table to share in all that Jesus has prepared for us.
Through Jesus dying and rising for us, he has taken our sin and our guilt.
We are here to celebrate that good news and to experience Christ's presence with us.
God of all creation, all of your made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
This is the Lord's table, and all are welcome to it. You may be seated. Thank you. the blessing. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you, keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Blessed be your name, O God, for we have feasted on your word, Jesus Christ, the joy and delight of our hearts. Strengthened by this food, send us to gather the world to your banquet, where none are left. None are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
The God of glory, Jesus Christ, name above all names, and the Spirit who lives in you, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We join in our closing hymn, Beautiful Savior, 838.
Thanks be to God.